So let's talk about Romans chapter 9, this idea of there are some verses in there that sort of, if read alone, they might lead us to believe in this idea of predestination, because this is a chapter that is strongly used by those that take this theology. And what predestination is, it's the idea that God chose you, but he didn't choose you. He didn't choose you, but he chose you. And I understand that I'm not upset with these people that feel this way. There are several verses that might lend one to think that, in fact, God has predestined some of us. And especially once we get into Romans 9, the word predestination is in the Bible. It's a longer story there. But in context, let's talk about a few other verses before we talk about those verses in Romans 9. You know, Matthew 23:37 might tell us differently. He says, "How often I wanted to gather you, your children, together as he gathers chickens under his wings, yet you were not willing." See, so in Matthew here, we see that God wants to gather them, but somebody's not willing. So it seems like they have a choice, as we do when we call on the name of the Lord. You know, if we read into Romans chapter 10, verse 13, it says, "Whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved." So apparently, we're supposed to be doing some calling. And then you get into John 12:32, it says, "When the Son of Man is lifted up, he will draw all men unto himself." Now, he's not drawing some, he's not drawing a few or a good chunk of them. God is actually drawing all men. You know, the Bible even says God wishes that none would perish. No, not one. So then we get into Romans chapter 9, which would seem to imply predestination, that, well, God is going to cause and force some people to perish because he's not going to choose them. So let's talk about a couple of those verses here. I want to start out, and if I may, I want to read how Paul starts out his letter in Romans 9, verses 2 through 4. He says, "I have great sorrow and unceasing grief in my heart, for I wish that I myself were accursed, separated from Christ for the sake of my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh, who are Israelites." So you see, right out of the gates, we see Paul's heartbroken here because he sees that he thought, you know, all the Jews were chosen, all the Jews were predestined. But Paul's realizing, no, that's not the case. They're not all chosen. They're not all predestined. And it's breaking Paul's heart. He'd be willing to give up his own salvation that maybe his brothers would be saved. Now, of course, Paul knows the reason they're not saved. Paul doesn't think this is predestination. We'll get into that in just a second there. So, but a couple of those verses, we start in Romans chapter 9, verse 12. This comes up. It says, "Jacob I loved, but Esau I hated." Now, it's very interesting there. You might read that and say, ooh, now, note what's not being said. Predestination. I choose you, but not you. What if Paul's defending his ministry that, hey, guess what? Salvation isn't just for the Jews. I am here to bring it to all the Gentiles too. Who would have a problem with that? Well, the Jewish people would. Their idea was nobody can be saved, especially them dirty Gentiles, except for the chosen ones, the Gentiles. And here's the twist in the story we later learn. The gospel is for everyone. God is drawing all men into himself, not just those clean Jewish people, but also those dirty Gentiles are being included. And the idea is, hey, if you have a problem with that, Jewish people, God is God. He can do what he wants. And here's an example. Jacob I love, but Esau I hated. And he's a Jewish person. Interestingly enough, we know something about Esau. What did he do? Well, he gave up his birthright. We have a birthright in Jesus Christ that we can receive, or we can give it up by denouncing who Jesus Christ is. We advance a little forward, a little further down to verse 15 in chapter 9 of Romans. He says, "I'll have mercy on whom I want to have mercy, and I'll have compassion on whom I want to have compassion." Well, who is he at? But prior to all this, who does he have mercy on? It seems like he has it on the Jewish people. Who's not really seeming to receive any mercy? Well, those dirty Gentiles. They're not chosen. They're without hope, right? There is no promises for them. And now the idea is that, hey, this is God. He can do what he wants. He's the God of the universe. And if I want to have mercy on those dirty Gentiles, and I want to have compassion on them, I'll have mercy and compassion on whom I want to. He is God. Romans 9, chapter 20, verses 21, he says, "The thing molded will not say to the molder, Why did you make me like this? Will it? Or does not the potter have the right over the clay to make from the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another one for common use? Well, in context, who was made for honorable use? Well, apparently it seemed like the Jewish people were, you know, the chosen ones, the one with all the promises. And who was made for common use? Well, that again would have been us dirty Gentiles. So we look at all this and we've got, we've got these other stories that seem to imply we've got a role, we need to call on the name of the Lord. And then we have all these verses, I hated Jacob and Esau, can I not do what I want? And what's the whole context here? Well, I believe Romans 9 is really Paul defending his ministry. He's saying, God is God. Who are you to say, you Jewish people, that the Gentiles can't be included? I'm here to tell you the Gentiles are included. What makes me think that, aside from all of what I just said? Well, if we conclude that chapter, I think Paul drives it home. He says, so hey guys, all those freaky verses I just said, here's my point. And this comes from Romans chapter 9, beginning in verse 30 through 32. Paul says, well, what shall we say then? In other words, hey, after all those 29 verses I just went through, what should we say? And here's what he says. That Gentiles, you know, us dirty Gentiles, who did not pursue righteousness, attained righteousness, even though righteousness, which is by faith. But the Israel pursuing a righteousness did not arrive at the law. Why? Because they did not pursue it by faith, but as though it were by works. In other words, us dirty Gentiles, we never looked for God. We didn't try. We didn't do any law keeping. But we had one thing. We believed. We had faith, and we got saved, but those chosen ones, those Jewish people, here's the newsflash. They pursued God by works of the law, and they did not attain righteousness because they didn't pursue it by faith. And that's the point of Romans chapter 9. It is not about God going down the street, picking this one and rejecting this one. We have a decision to make. We have to call on the name of the Lord to be saved. And I think Paul made that very clear in Romans 9. God bless you.